You have a purpose, and you're not too old or too far gone to find it and live it. In fact, every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do.
Welcome back to the Find Your Purpose Now podcast. You know, the whole point of this is loving your life, loving yourself, living the life you were born to live. And there are so many aspects of this. There are so many clues to our purpose. And one of the things that I wanted to share today might be on the more subtle side of purpose, but that doesn't mean it's insignificant. So here's what I mean. I realized that one of the ways that we can move toward the fulfillment of our purpose has a lot to do with gratitude, a positive, optimistic attitude, and a sense of gladness. Now, here's what I mean, okay? If you walk into a room with, you know, there are people in the room, and you walk in, and on the faces of the people in the room are scowls, angry looks, or looking down at you, disappointed, disgusted. Wow. What does that do for you? What does that do for your self-esteem? Not much. It certainly doesn't do anything for your confidence level. In fact, if anything, your confidence level can just go right down into the tank. When you walk into a room and the face that you see is a disappointed face, an angry face, a disgusted face. Well, on the other hand, if you walk into a room and the person in the room lights up when they see you, and they're so glad to see you, and you, it's obvious that you've brightened their day by showing up, what does that do for you? How does that make you feel? Good, right? It doesn't mean that if there's somebody in your life who, when you walk into the room, they light up and they're very glad to see you, it doesn't mean that everything is just going to fall into place and everything's going to just happen magically. But you're far more likely to be chosen as a friend, as an employee, as a business partner. You're far more likely to have opportunities when you're the person who lights up when somebody else walks into a room, who enthusiastically greets someone when they call. Think about it. You don't want somebody to pick up the phone and say the equivalent of, "What do you want? I'm busy right now." No, somebody can say hello, but in their words, the way they say the words, the tone, they might as well say, "Why are you bothering me right now?" Maybe they don't say those exact words, but you get it. You're smart. You pick up on all those things that are between the lines that are being said without being said. On the other hand, if you call and somebody picks up the phone and says, "Oh my gosh, I'm so happy to hear from you. How are you? What's going on with you? I need an update." You know, what they're saying is, "I care about you." When you flip it and you're the person who lights up when somebody walks in the room, who enthusiastically greets someone, who calls or FaceTimes or whatever, and if you can make that switch from what you were thinking about, what you were engrossed in, whatever the situation, and when someone presents themselves to you, if you can change the channel on what you were focused on and thinking of to this human being who's in front of you, it will mean so much to that other person. Now think about, if you do that for everyone in your life, you will be surrounded with people who care about you because of the way you make them feel. Think about a time when you were little and you walked into the room and someone lit up when they saw you. Was it grandma, your mother, father, aunt, uncle? Did somebody light up when you walked in the room? If you had that experience, you know how that feels, how good that feels, and how it bolsters you. If, on the other hand, you had the kind of childhood like I did, where you walk into the room to scowls, looks of disappointment, anger, even disgust, I can tell you what it did for me, or to me. We think we're not enough. We're not good enough. We get our self-esteem from the looks in the faces of the people we care about, the people who are in authority over us, the people who we love and we want them to love us. You may not have had somebody who lit up when you walked into the room, but here's the good news. You can be that person for everybody in your life. For everybody within your influence, you can be the one who says, "Oh, I'm so happy to see you. What's going on with you?" It's transformational, really. See, you think it's such a little thing. It's a subtle thing. It's an inconsequential thing, but it's really big. It can be so big because people remember you when you make them feel good about themselves. So, these relationships with the people who cross your path, who you are genuinely glad to see, and you let them know it, those things, those relationships will enhance your life in a way that things never could. And it's in that joy of really connecting with other people that the path of our purpose or to our purpose can sort of come alive. When we begin to see it, when we begin to notice how we feel when we're interacting with people who we delight in and they delight in us, we just feel better. It's in those times that beautiful clues to our purpose can be revealed. Okay, so this may sound unrelated, but it's very related. Choosing to make eye contact, to light up when you see someone, sometimes is a real effort. Not because you don't love that person or care about that person, because life happens. And what if you're in the middle of something that's extremely frustrating and maybe you're angry, maybe your cable bill just went up and, you know, you don't know where that money's going to come from or whatever. So you're, you know, what the things of life are real, the emotions around them are real, and somebody just happens to walk into the room right in that moment and you don't light up. You're already lit up, if you know what I mean. And so that person, especially a young person, especially a child, can think you're angry with them. You're upset with them. You're disappointed with them. You're disgusted with them. See how this is connected? So controlling our emotions is really, really important to living our purpose. Because the bottom line is, our purpose always involves us being the best possible person we could be, being the kindest person that we know how to be, being the most patient, the most merciful, the most, you know, think of all the good qualities that you want in a person. Of course, you want your friends, your family, your loved ones, your significant other person to be a person of integrity. You don't want to be lied to. You don't want them to be a lying liar. you don't want them to be miserable. You don't want them to be a thief. I mean, think of all the things. We want the people in our lives to be good people. You will attract those people. You model that behavior for the people around you when you're the best that you can possibly be. When we do that, we're literally showing everybody within our influence, this is how it's done. So then when something happens where we're really upset, it's up to us to learn to control our emotions. Wait for the right time to express our emotions. Choose the right way to express our emotions. Process our thoughts before we just blurt out our emotions. This way, you can shift once you are really conscious of choosing to control what's going on in your head and your heart, you're far more likely to be able to light up when someone you care about comes into the room. It doesn't mean that you're being disingenuous because you don't greet them with anger, disappointment, fear, you know, whatever it is that you're feeling in that moment. No, it's really a matter of self-control and timing. Greet them. Find out how they are. Ask how they're doing. And when the time is right, after you have made it clear, not only with words, but your facial expression, your body language, all of it, after you've made it clear that you care about them, you love them, you're happy that they're there, then say, I'm really frustrated right now. Or I'm so angry right now. Explain why. But when you lead with love, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness, humility, you know, all those good character traits, then the people around you will be better able to separate your anger, disappointment, whatever it is, from themselves. The last thing we want to do is leave people feeling worse off than we found them. So if you're angry and you're frustrated and it's just exuding from you, where's it going? If there are people around you, it's splashing up on them. And some of them may take responsibility for things that aren't theirs to be responsible for. Some of them will absorb that negativity from you, those negative emotions, and that's never good. It's not good for our mental health or physical health. It's easier said than done, controlling our emotions. But the Bible says, God says in His Word, that we can take our thoughts captive. I know some of you are like, wait, what? What does that really mean? I look at it like this. To me, it's like changing the channel on the TV with the clicker. If all of a sudden I have a fear, a thought that's fearful, oh, that pain, what if that pain is cancer? What if that means I'm going to die? What if that means, oh, I mean, really, we can get ourselves worked up over anything. The person we love is 5 minutes late. What's he doing? Who's he with? What's going on? Okay. So you see, we all have the ability. Some of us have the propensity, but we all have the ability to have a thought that just runs off the rails into fear, worry, anxiety, depression, anger. So at the first thought of, oh, that pain, maybe it's cancer. This is where you have an opportunity to notice what you're thinking about and take it captive and say, no, I'm not going there. I am just not going there. Mm-mm. If the pain persists, I'll go to the doctor and, you know, maybe run some tests and we'll find out what it is. But right now, I'm not going to worry about it. I'm going to think about something else. And then you change the channel on your mind. And you can do that. Don't act like you can't. You can. We all can. That's one of the beautiful things about the human mind. We don't have to let our thoughts racing all the time, the committee in our head talking to us all the time, arguing back and forth, and whatever else is going on in there. Because why? Because there's so much information going in between the internet and the TV and videos and emails and texts and phone calls. There's just a lot going in. Well, we can choose what we want to think about. Or we can let all of that stuff that's going in and pinging around in our heads like a pinball machine, we can let that control us. That's not good. I think we're happy, more contented, have a greater level of wellness to the degree that we feel in control. Now, we cannot control all the circumstances in our lives. You know, we can't control whether it's going to be hot or cold today. I mean, I guess we have some modicum of control over if we drive and we make it safely to the other place. But guess what? There are 7 billion people on the planet. There are a whole lot of other people driving on the road who may or may not have any level of competency in their driving. Some of them are drunk. Some of them are on drugs. Some of them are not in their right mind. These people are driving on the road. Okay, well, I can let that, I can think about that thought, and I can let that instill fear in me to the point that I don't want to leave the house. Or I can change the channel on my mind and say, look, oh, this train's running out of control. I'm getting off of that train. I'm going to get on this train. And I am going to be as safe as I possibly can. I'm going to make sure that I have safe tires. I'm going to make sure that my car is well-maintained. I'm going to make sure that my windshield wipers are fresh and all the things that you're supposed to do to keep your car maintained so that you know that you're safe and that you're paying attention when you're driving and whatever else. I'm just using that for an example, but you get the idea. To the degree that we have control over ourselves, our emotions, our thoughts, our circumstances, and we exercise the control that we have, we're happier. We're free then to move toward fulfillment of our purpose. If we're consumed with worry, fear, anxiety, we might miss it. And that's so sad. This is why I'm doing this. I don't want you to miss the beautiful purpose for your life because there's nothing like it. You matter. Your purpose matters. You are enough. You have everything you need or access to everything you need in order to find and truly fulfill your purpose. And to the degree that you control your emotions, take your thoughts captive, cast your cares. This is another thing that God tells us in his word to do. Cast your cares on him, meaning tell him what you're worried about and ask him to take care of it. And then trust that he will. And do what you're led to do. Do your part by all means. Wait for him to let you know what your part is and then do your part. But in the meantime, change the channel and think about something else. Think about things that are good fun. Think about lovely things. Think about beautiful things. That's another scripture in the Bible. Think about things that are pure and lovely and, you know, all those kinds of things. Sorry that I can't tell you the chapter and verse. If you know the chapter and verse for those scriptures, post it in the comments. I never said I was a theologian. But I know something about this because my brain is firing 24/7. I have 450 ideas every minute of every day. So learning to control my thoughts, take my thoughts captive, be able to change the channel in my thoughts was critical for me finding and living my purpose. Because as long as the committee in your head continues to, you know, spin out of control, you're not going to move forward. And as long as your emotions are in control, it's on your face. If you're worried, got the worried look. If you're fearful, got the fear look. I'm not a good actress. I don't know if I'm making the right looks, but you get it. The anxiety look, the depression look, the sad, you know, all that stuff. Well, you can't light up really genuinely, and people know if you're faking it. So if you're controlled by these thoughts and emotions and fears and worry and anxiety, you can't really be fully present with the person or people who are in front of you. Who, if you really delight in them, you'll change their, you'll raise their self-esteem, which could change the trajectory of their lives and could change yours too, because they will remember you and want to be with you. And opportunities will present themselves that you may not even now be able to imagine. Because the person who feels like you really delight in them tells other people. And maybe that person says to somebody else, and that person says, oh, I've been looking for exactly that kind of person with that kind of ability to make people feel loved and wanted and welcomed. We need that person in our organization. The next thing you know, you've been chosen for a job. You've been chosen to serve on a board, head up a committee, whatever it is. I don't know. But those are the things that lead you step by step by step right into the sweet middle of your purpose. Okay, that's it for today. Join me again next week, and let's just keep going with this until you are in the sweet, unbelievable, beautiful middle of God's purpose for your life. See you then.
Every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do. The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do. Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.